as I do. And I never thought I'd feel this way, the way I feel about you.
I've always had a soft spot in my heart for large groups. There's so many people in the band, they can't possibly be in it for the money. Well, Madness are in it not just for the music, but for the fun. And the fun that they've given so many British record buyers has been translated into 13 top 10 singles in only 3.5 years. And right now, they're currently enjoying European chart positions all over the continent. Their album is being very well received in the United States. Suggs, you're the lead singer of Madness. You've gone from doing ska tributes to pop songs, which obviously translate all across the world. Were you aware of a transition?
No, I don't think we were really aware of any changes that have been made in the band. I don't really know why we're so successful. I've no idea at all.
You have a reputation of being a North London group, and so often those two words, Camden Town, are associated with you. That is a part of North London, which foreigners wouldn't know. But do you feel that that is an important part of your identity, that you do have place loyalty?
I mean, I just think that you should write songs about things you understand, so I think maybe that's the reason it crops up a lot of the time.
My kind of town, Camden Town is...
When we did the Seven album, we went and recorded it in Nassau in Compass Point Studios, where Tom Tom Club and Talking Heads do a bit of stuff. And we found that we didn't feel good doing it abroad.
And yet, this neighborhood strikes me as being something like South Boston in the United States. People don't actually move out of it, they just move into nicer houses. Is that true?
Well, yes, that's very true. It's not exactly a very poor area, and it's not a very rich area either. It's a bit of both.
It's said that if ever the London taxis or the red buses leave London, the whole place
the
will sink
abdicate
into the clay here.
Well, mind you, it's only a rumor.
The Rise and Fall was your album, which was more of a serious look than you'd done before. And you were looking at the decay of an industrial British town. And you yourself wrote the song about Liverpool, didn't you?
Yeah. No, it's just about the decay of a city, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Liverpool in particular, because they had the riots, and a lot of it got knocked down. It's not a very big place.
The sun shines east, the sun shines west, but I know where the sun shines.
Well, when you started off, the group was known as the Invaders.
Yeah.
And the whole process of becoming Madness was shown in the film, Take It or Leave It, a feature film, which I loved.
A worthwhile film.
It was with soul, spirit.
Yeah. Actually, in the film, yeah. There is, yeah, the Rock On Record Shop. The Rock On Record Shop.
Yeah, very good.
And one of you is shoplifting.
Which one is that?
I guess it's the one it was.
No.
That's the one it was.
Did you find it oddly recreating circumstances from your past?
No, not really. Like, we all put our ideas in, so it was fairly easy. Plus, it was true, you know, well, 99% true to life. You know, dramatised bits of it.
You Thompson, our new driver?
Yeah.
You're late.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Should have been here an hour ago.
I know, yeah, I was sort of...
First day on the job and you're late?
Yeah, sorry.
Hope you're not going to carry on this way.
No.
All right. Now, get that van out there. Yeah. Keys are in it, right? Yeah. Back it in. Yeah. Stephen will help you. Yeah. Want all this scaffolding on.
Right.
Breeze blocks. Drainware pipes and 400 flattens, right?
Okay.
Now see you at the site. Stephen knows the way, he'll show you.
Right, Steve. Okay, sorry about that.
All right.
Wait, Steve. What are flattens?
Yeah, them bricks here.
Oh. Is that a lot?
There was that hysterical sequence driving the van under a railway bridge, and the van didn't...
How
long have you been working here?
Oh, about a year.
Yeah, what's that foreman like?
He's okay, but he's got a thing about being on time.
Yeah, I know.
Here, do it right here.
What, there? Come. It's a one-way.
Time, where you been, John of Groats? Come on, let's get it unloaded.
Yeah, there was a bit of traffic.
Hey! What happened?
Yeah, I'll tell you what. You can stick your job. It's too dangerous. Post me pay onto us.
Lee enjoyed the bits of it with him in.
They were really good bits. I just
especially when he didn't have to talk.
I thought I'd want attention.
No, they were really good bits. They were in black and white. I think the whole film should have been black and white.
We like to think of Lee like a little flower, a little bud, a little bulb in a pot.
Just blooming. I'm ready to bloom. It's a bit cold today. I've shriveled up.
Oh, look, there's all pollen.
Smoking one for love, printed persons lots of times, in lost stars and moonshine. Stars
are a dime!
On the beach, we can try safely, on the run down to the lead, let's do the beauty, come to be never free, we can lead, let's do, cause I'm on the beach, we come in front of her, let's try to take one, soon as a lady for a seat, we find our seat, you would have had a wonder if you had your death, the beauty, cause I'm on the beach, we've been...
Carl, you were creating a character in the group at the beginning, and you perhaps more than anyone created that image of fun because you were the house dancer. You didn't actually perform on many instruments, and you even had a different name as Chad Smash. How did that come about?
That came about... I used to be in the band at the beginning, but I left. And Lee, the sax player, asked me along to introduce them one night, and I just enjoyed it and sort of
wouldn't get off the stage
and stayed with them.
It is your voice, isn't it, on the beginning of One Step Beyond?
Yeah, well, that's one of the reasons, too, that sort of kept me in there, because I did the sort of one step.
I mean,
that sort of got me into the band, yeah.
Yes, it's really those opening words, hey, you,
that started a fashion, a craze, a way of life.
Yeah. Hey, you, don't watch that. Watch this. This is the heavy, heavy monster sound.
and nothing is sound around. So as you coming off the street and you're beginning to feel the heat, well, listen, Buster, you better start to move your feet to the rockin'est, rock steady beat of madness. One step beyond.
Pop songs don't always need to be fully explained for an audience around the world to understand them. But nonetheless, some of your recent songs do have very British references in them. For example, Mrs. Hutchinson, about the National Health Service. What's the origin of that one?
Mike, the keyboard player, his mother went into hospital. She was told she had cancer. And she went around for a day thinking she had cancer, you know. And at the end of the day, the doctors apologized for giving her the wrong information. And it's basically about that. There's something that little lips said. I just don't forget me. Won't let you wonder. Just not what I suppose. It seems so. This is something that little lips said. I thought I diagnosed. Well, not to worry. Just not what I suppose. But sit down, son, your mother's very real. We may have to operate, it's more than just a chill. But don't you worry, it's all in competent hands. We will leave it, son, to the ribs of one of the glass. Well, Mrs. Hutchinson, eat up your breakfast. Don't smoke, it's thanks you grow. Stick to your diet. Let's hope that you're insured. Corporate efforts, a couple of members of the group. I would imagine that really people are just flinging songs at each other all the time. Is that the way it goes?
No, not at all. Unfortunately for Dave Robertson.
Who is the head of Stiff Records?
Yeah, sorry. What usually happens is we spend a lot of time touring and doing television stuff and then travelling around, and then a rather smaller amount of time either on our own or together writing very few songs very slowly.
When I thought of some of your early live shows, when you would be dancing all over the stage as Chaz Smash, people would be dressing up as camels and so forth, the presentation would have to be altered somehow to accommodate this new album, and it has evolved, hasn't it? How's it changed?
We've got a lot of new sounds, yeah. People have to do more work musically, which means they can't do as much visually. So I think on the last tour that we did, we had string players, yeah, and the brass band. We were trying to make the stage itself more interesting, as opposed to trying to think of different things
because
to do ourselves.
Because you yourselves can't be the nutty boys that you used to be.
Well, we still can, I think, but it's just that...
We're just a bit more restricted by...
But, yes. No, we've knowingly restricted ourselves, I think. Yeah. We knowingly did. Mm-hmm. But with incorporating the things, and then incorporating the brass and the extra trumpet, it was really, you know, it gave the audience a lot more to see.
I've never had much cause for worry, and I've not got a lot to say. You'll never find me in a hurry, because I live my life day by day. People say that I'm crazy, but I'm not that way inclined. I know what I know, and I have really shown that madness is all in my mind. 24 hours is all that I care for. I believe that's the only way. 24 hours is all that is needed, because I live my life day by day. I'm crazy, but I'm not that way inclined. I know what I know, and I have really shown that madness is all in my mind.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Police.
When Chris writes it, it was just about his state of mind at the time, I think.
I'm happy the way that I do things, continually feeling okay. The worries of what tomorrow brings.
Madness is the name of the group, and you were responsible for naming the group, weren't you?
Well, yeah, that was because it was a song we did in our set, which we still do. And somebody says, let's name ourselves after one of our songs. So I said, oh, yeah, Madness, you know, is an utter joke. And everybody said, yeah, yeah, you know. Which I didn't like the name at the time, but it seems to suit us now.
You've grown on it.
And others in degenerate ways. But me, I don't care much for the questions. Madness is all in my mind. Madness is all in my mind. Madness is all in my mind. Madness is all in my mind.
We would like to involve ourselves in all the decisions that are made about the group. And,
Of course, Dave Ellison helps a great deal.
Yeah.
His fatherly advice.
A guide and mentor.
Always good, never with his own, you know, interests at heart.
Pan that camera around there, it's just to show Dave Ellison.
Let's see it over there.
Is that a light? Is there enough
light? That is it. That is a man.
Sign a contract, do you demand anything? You know, some groups like...
Chris won't have any red Smarties in the bowl of Smarties.
Nice, green ones.
Sort of instruments video, you know, so there's not many ideas, but we had such fun making it, you know, because we were all a bit drunk and we just got some gold discs and all this sort of thing, you know. We were under tremendous pressure. We were just going to America, you know. The record company said we don't want to make a video, then they said we do, and we had to do it at 12 o'clock at night, but we had good fun, you know. It came out all right. We'll be right back.
you weren't singing through all of that number. Is that because you didn't have enough words?
Yes.
Who is it who puts the conception behind the stage design for your shows?
With everything, it's the usual way we do things is everyone talks it over. The whole seven of us talk things over and...
Fling ideas about.
Yeah, just shooting ideas. Some things are not possible, some are too costly, etc. And we come down to what we want and the best way to do it.
Mm, yeah.
It's democratic, really.
How did the song Primrose Hill come about?
Well, I had written some sort of music, you know, but it wasn't really structured at all. And then we just kept sort of churning it out, you know, and Suggs came along with some lyrics.
Because Primrose Hill is a real place.
It is,
in
yeah.
London.
I was on that hill, oh no, I've never been there. I wish I was there still. I'd better jump back with someone I see the world in a part.
When they actually came on the stage, it was brilliant, you know, because it wasn't anything amplified. It was just absolutely acoustic.
Were they afraid?
And very loud.
Were they afraid you were going to overpower them?
I think we were both, as you know, all of us were as nervous as each other about
it worked,
the outcome.
It really came well. It was really stirring. It really sounded great.
Yeah. Yeah.
On your most recent tour, you had another kind of visual aid because to illustrate the song of the Blueskin Beast, you had film footage of material relating to the Falklands.
That's right.
Yes. Yeah. What was it that you had and where'd you get it?
Well, as it goes, our bass player, Bedders, organised getting the film from the film library. And in the Blueskin Beast film, we had shots up of First World War, Second World War. We also had some of a lookalike Margaret Thatcher, and we couldn't get hold of any film of her because the film libraries wouldn't let us have them.
Really?
It's just a shame. But a lot of the people that come to see us, I think, understood the song more because of that film.
I can play you to your loved ones, but I can promise no return to a shell shock God forsaken. Where the craters still labor, have a drink of it, have a drink of it. I heard you shampoo yesterday, but I was sleeping on the job. And I dreamt of fighters miles away, whose lives I had to rob. Have
Did you know what it was about?
I think that's one of the reasons why I quite like Lee's songs. I'm very fond of Lee's lyrics. Because you don't have to actually... Cheers, Lee. You know, that's the reason I think that he writes them in that style, is that you don't have to particularly look that deeply into them if you don't want to. Okay, Lee?
Yeah, that's all right, yeah.
Does that make sense?
That's great, fine, next question.
You have this medal, you can't even mount it down. Time you turn around, I can find your loved ones to you, with guarantee of no return. And if John Wayne dummies bounce off, don't look shocked when it comes your turn. Have a drink on me, I'll put it down, to the girl baby. Bridges to the blue skin, please step in, to the blue skin, step in.
Madness have won awards in Great Britain as some of the best promotional films being made.
Yeah.
Is that because you take particular care on them, or are you actually one-take wonders who happen to get it right the first time?
I think the main thing is that we all get on, so we're not embarrassed in each other's company, which is always good, which means you can, you know, let yourself go.
He would always act really stupid, you know. So I have little costumes made for him, like a traffic warden's one with...
The
he refuses to wear them, but you know.
Our house, it has a crowd. There's always something happening, and it's usually quite loud. Our mum, she's so house proud. Nothing ever slows her down, and a mess is not allowed.
I mean, generally, we just try and think of as many visual ideas as we can that we can do ourselves that don't involve a lot of props and money.
Father gets up late for work. Mother has to iron his shirt. Then she sends the kids to school. Sees them off with a small kiss. She's the one they're going to miss in lots of ways.
Well, Our House is a song which flows along. Did it strike you when you made it as one which was a particularly commercial number? Because it has proved to be so.
Oh, yeah, when it was recorded, I knew it was a smash, you know. But, I mean, when I wrote it, I mean, the music, it was like a sort of, like, dirge, you know, and Carl came in and he says, oh, I've got these lyrics, and then we sort of had it, you know, and then it was pretty easy from there on.
Mm-hmm.
So it didn't take that long to write, I suppose.
I remember when I came and everything was true, when we would have such a very good time, such a fine time, such a happy time. And I remember how we'd play, simply waste a day away, then we'd say nothing would come between us to dream it.
groups just staying in with their instruments, you know, which is pretty boring, and we've done some without instruments altogether. But usually the best thing to do is, you know, do it with instruments, so you know you've got that, and that's... And then you just have a load of various other ideas, like, you know, playing a guitar underwater, or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, as long as you, you know, once you've got the backbone for an idea, then the rest comes on the day. The rest of the ideas are just laying about in front of you.
In the middle of our street, our house, in the middle of our house, was our castle and our king, our house. In the middle of our street, our house, that was where we used to sleep, our house. In the middle of our street, our
house. It does seem that you really use ingenuity rather than big budgets.
Well, I think if it's just a good idea, it's a good idea, and you don't really need to sort of embellish it too much. And we try to keep to a strong but simple theme without using, you know, as Suggs said, too many expensive things.
When we turn up at the video places, we've also got beds on the coach.
And we've got name tags, so there's no trouble, you know.
It can have a gigantic effect on record sales, can it?
Yeah, if it's a good video. And also, the song has to be good as well, which a lot of people overlook. Do you know what I mean? Some people make a really fancy video for a really naff song.
Your drummer, Woody, said that the first time he saw you, he thought that all the other acts on the bill were better musically, but that you had some kind of brilliant energy. Now, Suggs, from the point of view of someone watching the group, do you think he was right?
Yeah, definitely. What do you think, Donkey?
You weren't in the group at the time, were you?
There was an inner power, I think, madness of an inner jollity, an inner frivolity that sort of permeates
sometimes
into the crowds around us.
Why do you call him Donkey?
He always calls me Donkey.
That's good.
There were rumours that at first there was a bit of violence at your gigs. Was that the case?
There were a lot of skinheads at the early gigs, and consequently there were sometimes, you know, incidents. But, I mean, yeah, that all came from the sort of the scar thing, which we didn't really want to get that associated with anyway. Mm. But, like, we've just been on tour recently, and then they were pretty manic, actually, compared... Mm. I mean, I think it often depends what the latest single is. When we had My Girl out, we'd have a lot of young girls. When we had One Step Beyond out, we had a lot of skinheads. When we put The Rise and Fall out, we had a lot of university professors.
You had done some commercials for Japan. I mean, that was a different thing. Were those made by you as well?
No, they had a sort of basic idea of what we were about from watching our videos, you know? Mm. So then they got us doing the Nutty Train, you know, and we did a few adverts. Mm.
Now, the Nutty Train is where you all line up
with
your arms
line,
like the...
Turbo! City Turbo!
Now, we try and do it very fairly. We put all the money in a room, and we
turn the lights out,
and we all dive in.
We're all our rubber coshes.
Well,
I'll tell you the truth.
Like, no, I'll tell him the truth.
You don't know. He doesn't know the truth.
What we do is...
Lift the floorboard.
If two people write a song, that's two people. That's probably one of him and one of me.
We're a good combination, us.
Good combination. What we do is, the writers, or the writer, gets 50%, and the other 50% is split equally amongst the bands, so that we're always happy.
Always happy.
It's about as fair as you can get.
City in city. City.
It will catch your eye in the city.
City はニュースにあふれている。ライブビークル、ホンダシティ。
It seems that some of the singles that you've had in the British top 10 have been almost coincidental successes. Other they'd been lying around for some time and you decided to cut them again. I guess a case like that was Grey Day, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, yeah. I mean, I don't know how other bands go about writing and recording, But we tend to use up nearly all the stuff that we write in one way or another. I mean, it's odd, really, that there are so many of us writing, but we don't actually have that large amount of turnover of material. But Grey Day was just something that we'd had knocking about for years that never really got properly finished, and then...
And then you had a smoke.
Smoking is bad for you, the general surgeon.
It's Nicholas.
And, yeah, and then we just sort of revamped it once at rehearsals and we had nothing else to do, and it sounded quite effervescent.
When I get home, it's late at night. I black and bloody from my life. I haven't time to clean my hands. Cuts will only sting me through my dreams. It's well past midnight as I lie in a semi-conscious state. I dream of people fighting me without any reason I can see. In the morning I awake, my arms, my legs, my body aches. The sky outside is wet and grey. So begins another weary day. So begins another weary day.
After eating I go out. People passing by me shout. Why don't they talk to me, dear? In the park I have to rest. I lie down and I do my best. The rain is falling on my face. I wish I could sing without some choice. In the morning I awake. My legs, my body aches. The sky outside is wet and grey. So begins another weary day. So begins another weary day. In the park I have to rest. I lie down and I do my best. The rain is falling on my face. I wish I could sing without a trace. In the morning I awake. My arms, my legs, my body aches. The sky outside is wet and grey. So begins another weary day. So begins another.
record, which was actually two bits put together, wasn't it? House of Fun.
Yes, that's very interesting. We'd done this song called House of Fun. Was it called House of Fun?
At the time, it was The Chemist for Sale.
For some reason.
I'll tell the story, Chris, because I told it earlier.
I'll tell the story, because I blooming helped to write the blooming thing. Anyway, once again, the boss of the record company, very far-seeing man, said it hasn't got a chorus, you know, which we hadn't realised. Yeah, get another camera in here. It hadn't got a chorus, so we sort of wrote this chorus, recorded the chorus in various bits, and edited it into the record.
The tempos don't exactly match, do they?
Yeah, they do. When you're back, it's jazz.
It's jazz, you get anywhere.
No, I mean, it's a chorus, so it's a different, you know, it's a chorus, so it's a different tempo, you know, so what?
But it doesn't necessarily follow, but it is.
It's just very nicely and surgically put in.
We'd had an idea when we made the album to record a short piece of Tomorrow's Just Another Day with a double bass and like a sort of bluesy thing that would fade out echoey and ethereally into the rock version, pop version. but we didn't actually get around to it, so we continued with the idea, and after we'd made the album we recorded the track with just a double bass and piano. I had a go at singing it and couldn't really get around it very well. Carl had a better go. And
then Christopher walked in. Christopher Foreman, he's got sort of hair problem. But he walked in and he said, you know, why don't we get Elvis to sing it? And
because Clive had just started working with him, our producer. Mm. That was the main contact.
And then Clive spoke to Elvis, and Elvis said, presumably, yeah. And he came down and did it. It was really good, really moving, soulful stuff.
Did he show you any of his old Ray Charles albums?
He didn't, no, but he enthused about them, if I recall correctly.
Yes.
He enthused.
And then
profusely.
He sang under the song.
Yeah. He did, yeah, it was great.
It was good.
Did you think it was kosher to have a 12-inch release with someone else singing, or?
Very.
I mean, it'd be a lot better, I think, if a lot more people sort of, you know,
swapped about, interchanged ideas and things.
Trying hard, thought I'd done my best. All my life, I can't get no rest. Some who closed the door before said, I can't carry.
Feel we haven't got a single in our
pockets,
we don't put one out.
That's pretty honest.
Believe it or not.
Also, if we feel we've got one, we put it out. How about that? That's radical thinking.
Do you feel you have another one off of Rise and Fall for the
Bill? No, frankly, no.
Frankly, no.
No, we've got some new stuff. We've moved into a new direction now. We're messing around with frequency, and we're recording in all wood studios now. Before, it's always been concrete base studio floors, and we found that sound doesn't really
permeate.
It just doesn't happen as we would like it to happen.
You need.
So anyway, it's all wooden floors and natural pine and
lavender-scented
cushions in the mixing room.
Do you feel that the group is making progress in musical terms, or does it matter?
I think it matters, and I think we are. I suppose the experience that we've gained is from how to make it more interesting, you know, with harmonies and backing vocals and such like. But it's definitely becoming different.
I thought I'd done my best all my life. I can't get no rest. Leave me in this way. Down.
He's got it written down somewhere that we're going to do okay in America.
Yeah.
He keeps telling us.
Yeah.
In fact, he's gone there for 2 weeks, you know, he's so short.
To enthuse.
Don't know what he's been. I thought he was going for a few days. He's a bad boy, isn't he?
He's been gone for a week now, and we still can't find the keys to our homes. We don't know how to get in. If you see this soon, Matthew, please come home and let us in. Because
Milk's building up on the doors.
Petty cash slips are locked in your drawer and we can't get to them.
Do you look forward to going back to the United States this time?
Not at all.
Oh, yeah. We really wanted to sign a Geffen because they sent a representative over, John, I believe his name was.
John Goodell.
And he walked into our office and he had a really long beard, you know, and I like a geezer with a beard. And he was wearing a hat with the stars and stripes on it. He said, America needs you. And we said, that sounds like a good deal.
When you first went to the States, did people think, this group needs cups of tea all the time? Did you think that that they thought you were too English?
I don't know. I think the majority of people thought we'd just left Marine training or something. That's the first step when we went there. People used to think we were Army cadet kids or something. I really
on and off, we used to a lot more have our hair quite short, which is not the norm for most people in America.
And are you going to continue to mine a more serious vein, or do you know yet?
I'm not sure. I mean, we've talked about doing something slightly more
jolly.
In the dance pool, yes. We're going to jolly things up a bit, I think.
I get particularly wound up on stage, but I'm getting over it slowly.
Have you ever thought of becoming tax exiles and moving to somewhere like Mayfair?
No.
No.
Do you find that in real life you see each other as much as you used to?
Well, I still
in
see
real
Chris.
Life.
Well.
But is anything else a fantasy?
Well, it is sort of a bit of a fantasy.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we do. I think we see each other quite a bit.
One last question, not to you, to them. What is your favorite thing about being in the band?
Well, I find it really fulfilling and intellectually very stimulating.
Being in the band means to me that I can get my hair cut at Style, a really famous hair barber shop. As you can see, there's no grey hairs.
No, they're
each
put
one
in
is individually ones. Plucked out from the root. Carl?
I'm still trying to figure out why I'm in the band. I don't really know, but I'm sure I have a use.
That we can say so much without words. Bless you and bless me. Bless the bees and the birds.